Hello, everybody. This is Etho, and welcome back to another episode. So today, I think what we should do is work on the Nether Hub some more. It's been really helpful having these paths in the Nether, and these portals and everything, and I would really like to get it hooked up where I could actually use the minecarts. For most of the stuff so far, it's been pretty close. Like, the stronghold's not that far. I don't mind walking this. But hey, if there was minecarts, that would be even better. Yeah, stronghold's just over here, through this portal. But you can see I started going further. This track now goes all the way to my Nether fortress, where I've been hunting wither skeletons. And that is at about, I think it goes up to like 380 Z or something. So it's a little bit of a distance. So, minecarts. We want minecarts. Oh no, those are blank. I'm like, man, the text isn't loading again. But no, I never put any text for them because it's not set up. But yeah, we have our selector panel here. Fancy little thing to select our destination. So the way this is supposed to work, you pick your destination, it sends you down this main tunnel here, and then like at 10 different places along this tunnel, there's going to be a T junction with the minecart tracks. That will send you off to your X destination, when you get to it. So, the thing about that though, it's not as easy as it sounds. Like, in order to send information to those T junctions, I would have to run a redstone line from this main selector panel all the way to as far as it goes, you know. So if we have a junction 1,000 blocks away, we have to run a redstone line 1,000 blocks away. And one for each of these. Which is like, oh no, what have I done? I can't do that. So, yeah, we're gonna experiment with something today. There is ways I've seen, like, where people can send multiple signals with a single redstone line, using different lengths of pulses and stuff. We're gonna do something similar to that with minecart tracks. And this is an idea I played around with over a year ago now. I was gonna use it on Eats Road, and it seemed like it was working, but it's kind of complicated too. I don't know if it'll be successful or not. But like for these close junctions, like I would put a junction here to go to the stronghold. That's not that far. That's only like 40 or 50 blocks. I don't mind running redstone that far. But it gets to the point where you get hundreds and hundreds of blocks away. We need a better way of triggering the junctions for this to work the way I hoped it to. So we're gonna get some minecart stuff together. We're gonna go do it up in a nice grass area, nice flat grass area, and just experiment with an idea. And I'll see you there. All right, so here's the idea. Let's pretend this is our main track, the main line. We want it to branch off 10 different places down the way. Some of these might be hundreds or thousands of blocks away. All right, and we'll branch them off using a T junction like this. So if it's going like this, it'll keep going straight. If it's like this, it will go this way to the destination. Otherwise, it'll just keep going down the main track. Okay. Now, the problem is telling this junction to switch when we want it to. We got to make it ignore, but like we might have to make it ignore 9 of the junctions on the way, and then on the 10th one, have it switch, and that's kind of challenging. So usually the way people do this and we might end up doing this also if this doesn't work out too well, is you'll have your selector pad. So we got 10 choices. Then we'll have all our junction stuff all in one area, and it'll split into 10 different tracks. That's one way of doing it. Another way is to have 10 separate redstone wires running all the way down. Or we could try to be fancy and get one redstone wire with different length pulses going all the way down. But what I really want to do is make like a self-intelligent track that just knows this is where we want to go. And we can actually do that if we use two minecarts. So how should we set this up? I guess this is just going to be really rough, this test setup here. Once we actually do set it up, we have to be pretty specific about our timings and everything. Okay, so we'll have two minecarts, right? And we're going to use the time between one minecart and the other one to send information down the track to tell it when we want to get off. That's the goal with this. Now, one problem with this, an empty minecart does not move at the same speed as one that a player is riding in. So we'll have to put a mob in the second minecart. I'm going to use chickens for this, just because they're like the most portable mob. They're easy to replace if they disappear. Just throw a few eggs, you can get a chicken. All right. So today I finally set up a proper chicken farm in my world here. This whole time since I started my Let's Play world, I have not had a chicken farm of any kind. Well, I kinda did by the cow farm. There's been one chicken in the water for forever. finally decided to set up a temporary one by the purple sheep. I don't know if you know that pen. Today, and it's just getting going, but I did get 5 eggs. I'm really hoping we get a chicken out of this. Yes. Awesome. Quick, capture. Yes, okay. We got our helper. Right, okay. So the way I originally did this, I only used one detector rail. I'm talking like a year ago. The way I did it originally, I only used one detector rail. Basically, I had to put it before the T-junction. Like so. And let's get out our redstone. I basically made a switch with different delays. Kind of like a redstone fork, I should say. So on one path, the delay was like, actually no, the first thing I had to do is set up a monostable circuit. That's the very first thing, just so that it's easier to create unique IDs with the delays. This will all make sense once we get it going, don't worry. I hope. So monostable circuits. We'll put it over here. Do 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 do. I think that's right. I just want to see if it flashes properly. I think I need to set it to 3. Yeah, set it to 3. There we go. That's a monostable circuit. Just creates a quick pulse, only one tick in delay. Okay, so you get the monostable circuit, and then you have to have a fork of two different delays. One of them will be like instant, another one will be the delay between our two minecarts. So we'll just do this for now, and then these go into an AND gate. And it basically compares if the timings are equal, A current will pass through. If they are not, it will not pass through. And then this would connect to the junction. So we'll just do this for now. See how it lights up. And I do not know what delay we need. Well, let's see. Wait a sec. We'll just set it to a very short delay. And then we can control the release time of the second minecart from here by a delay from this button. This is how we give each button a unique ID. Again, I'm putting this together very rough, so it's not going to work the first time. I'll have to play with the timings. Let's just give it a delay like this and see how it works. And then that will send power to the track and send off the second minecarts. Power, power. One goes, two goes. Okay. So I'm going to fool around with this a bit and try to get the timings right so it'll make sense. I've made a few refinements to it to now, and I think I can demonstrate how it's supposed to work. So I got a lever hooked up here to do the same thing that the pressure, or that the detector rail does. So when you go over to the detector rail, that's what happens. You see that torch goes off first, and then that one as it goes through the delay. Now, another important thing about this monostable circuit is it's like, even if you keep this powered, it still only sends a pulse. It doesn't stay powered here. If it was to stay powered, it would always trigger. And these note blocks just tell us when it triggers properly, that it would trigger the junction up there. So if I time it right, though, if I send two pulses with the right timing, this one will trigger, which has no effect. Then this one will go. And then on the second time it goes over the rail, this one will trigger again. And if it matches up with this torch, if they both match at the same time, then it'll go through. And then also this will get triggered again, this side, but that doesn't matter. So let's see if I can time it right. Nope. Almost had it. There we go. You see what's happening there? Not too late. So the timing has to be very, very precise, and that's how we can control this at several different spots, just by having different timings. There is one thing, though. You see I have this set at 4 now, so it's actually a 2-tick pulse instead of a 1-tick. Ideally, we want a 1-tick. But the problem we're having, if we set this to this, this torch won't go off. It's too quick. See that? It just quickly flashes on and then off. The torch didn't change. Sort of a limitation of a redstone torch, but there is a way to trick it. If you have a repeater, at 1 tick it won't work. Still didn't change it. You set it to 2, though. Then it does, and it's still only a 1-tick pulse. It's kind of a trick. So we can put that at the start of this. Like that. Connect it to both of these. Oh. Oh, I didn't change it. There we go. There we go. So it changed. So we want the smallest possible number so we can... we don't have to use as much delay to make it unique, our code or our delay. But anyway, now there's also another limitation here. These detector rails, they stay powered for about a second, so our second minecart has to trail at least 8 blocks behind. I don't know the exact number, but minecarts move 8 blocks per second at max speed, so that's the distance we need. I'm just going to change this back to how it was, because I had it all synced here. I'll show you how it works. So our little helpers here. We lost our other chicken. I had to make a new one. So I would go first, chicken will follow behind. About that distance. And it triggered. If we change this timing just a little bit, it's not going to work. So if we add in another repeater, let's see if it works with this, just with one more tick. It might, I'm not sure. Oh, it still did. That's because this pulse is two ticks, so if we were to add one more, I don't think it'll work. That's why we want that as small as possible. So it shouldn't trigger, I'm pretty sure. Oh, okay. I know when I tried it before, like a year ago, I figured it out to being a 3 to 4 tick minimum difference between the IDs. Let's see if this one works. Still triggered. Wow. Maybe I'm doing something wrong here. If it does it again, I know I've done something wrong. So we've added a 4 extra ticks. Okay, that time it didn't go. So yeah, it's about a 4 tick buffer we need. 3 ticks if we can shorten this one more. And that's our minimum between IDs. So for each button, I need to add 3 ticks to the repeater. So the first one would be like 3 for the ID. The next one would be 6. Then the next button would be 9 and so forth, all the way up to our 10th button to code it, to code the signal between the minecarts. Yeah. So the tough thing about this, though, is going to be controlling the chickens, making sure we distribute them through the stations properly, or I might just try to set up a big chicken farm and get tons of eggs and always get a chicken that way by shooting eggs out of a dispenser into a minecart or something. I don't know. We'll have to figure it out, but maybe we'll do something else now. Oh yeah, I forgot to say, another idea I had was to use 2 detector rails instead of just 1 and have a monostable circuit for each one and an AND gate still, but I think that would eliminate the need for all this repeater business, this initial repeater business. Like, we could get rid of 4 repeaters doing that, possibly. I'm not sure. Alright, let's try to find something else to do. Oh, just a little correction here with what I said. You know that trick of tricking the torch here? It does not work, actually. This is at 1. It's going to be too quick to trigger it. Oh, actually, it did that time. Ooh, I actually timed it right. That's amazing. Huh, I saw it flicker that once. Yeah, did that time, too. But yeah, anyway, it's actually extending the pulse if I do it to 2. It'll work, but it's actually a longer pulse, and you can really see it if you extend it to 4. Yeah. So I'll have to just set that at 4. It'll be a 2-tick pulse. That's the minimum I can do and make this work. I'll have to have a difference of 4 ticks per button. So 1 repeater, which isn't too bad. And yeah. Alright. I guess the next part of trying to finish this hub is figuring out how we're going to do the tunnels. We need something that's fairly easy to reproduce. So I brought some blocks with us. I want it to be gas proof. Definitely. There's some areas are going to be like in the ground like this, and some areas are going to be out in the open. So I would like that to look good. I'd like to be able to see outside into the nether as I travel. And I like 3x3 tunnels for minecarts like this. It's a good size. So I think I'm going to do iron bars for looking out of. Although I am kind of tempted about these. Although I don't think you can see much through these, can you? Yeah, it's just a little crack. No, that won't work. Okay, we're going to use iron bars for the sides. I also want it to be relatively zombie pigment proof, so need to try prevent them from spawning. I would like them to be lit up to the tunnels if possible, so let's just play around with this idea a bit. So if the tunnel's 3x3, we need the, or if it's a 3x3 airspace, we need a 5x5 tunnel. Like this. Okay. Iron bars on the sides, maybe. Those would have to go 3 high. It's gonna take a long time to build this. I can tell already. Oh boy. Okay. See. Iron bars here. Oh yeah, so we played our second game of Race for the Wool. Spoilers. Spoilers, cover your ears if you want to watch it. I'm sure a lot of you have already. Either from my perspective or someone else that posted. But we lost, so we're out of the tournament. But we had a good time, and I'm glad we played. It was a lot of fun. Very, very difficult to beat those guys, oh man. We had our strategy all figured out, but you know, I kind of realized it after the game, but it was really unlike us to go for a rush strategy. Usually we're the guys trying to lock down resources and just muscle the team down, but that's exactly what happened to us, and we lost because of it. Very, very close, though. So congrats to those guys. I hope they do well in the tournament. And when I say those guys, I mean Team PME, Professional Minecraft Engineers. Yeah, the tracks we're going to do like this, our power boosts. We're going to have a detector rail, power rail, detector rail. So it'll work both ways. And we don't need any levers or redstone to power it. Yeah, to prevent zombie pigmen from spawning, we should have a block here. So maybe we'll use these. If we do that, we don't really need iron bars that low. So bring these up. And no, I'm not going to waste those iron bars. I'm going to pick them up. I'm not that rich. Oh boy, that gas sees us. If we put a light here, we'll have to put half slabs above. This we could shape better, so it looks better from the outside, using stairs, maybe. Actually, we could put them there, too. And here. And these stone bricks, I have plenty of cobble, so they're not hard for me to get. Yeah. Maybe something like this. Alright, anyway. It's going to be something similar to this. I might change it a bit yet. I do want to check out the anvils yet, so let's go do that, and then we'll probably call it an end for today. Okay, so this is the first anvil I've created. I don't know a whole lot about them. I'm going to try figure it out after this episode, probably. They look cool, I know that. I think I can pick it up with a pick. Yep, cool. I know they can be damaged by dropping them, and that they can hurt things by dropping them on them. You can launch them with TNT. A lot of thought really went into these things. I'm impressed. Like, they look cool. They have many different purposes. You can name stuff with them. They found a way to incorporate that feature in to vanilla, which is cool. Okay. You can repair items with them, I think. Like I said, I don't know too much about them. I think I read that you can actually upgrade levels if you combine two at the same levels. Not quite sure how that works. I'm just going to bring a few tools. We'll see what happens. Efficiency 4. Do I have another efficiency 4? I want to see if, like, if I do efficiency 4, if it if they become efficiency 5 or something, because that would be awesome. Does it say what I get? No, it doesn't say. Darn, I was hoping it would tell me what I could get. 5 levels to fix it? Do I have to name it? Oh, that's just to name it. How do I repair it? I probably don't have enough levels. This is really cool, because like stuff like looting swords, man, you could just repair them. Keep them forever. I still have this pick. I'm really hoping I can fix it. That would be awesome. 29 levels. To repair it? Or no, that's to name it. Man, I don't know what's going on. I should just go read a little bit right now. Yeah, I'm gonna read a little bit on this. Okay, I think I get it a little bit better now. I'm still gonna have to mess around with it a bit, but yeah, you can get a higher level. Like, you can get efficiency 5, which is awesome. I love that. I was kind of wondering if you can get like level 6 stuff, but it almost looks like you can't. Like, if you do 2 power 5 bows, it's still power 5, which is too bad. That would be really cool. Let's see. Efficiency 5. 26 levels before. Too expensive. I think you want the damage one in the second slot. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm gonna try to figure out all the formulas and stuff and figure out the numbers, and that's what I have to do when a new thing comes out. I don't know, I find it fun. Alright, let's read the comments, or a comment for today, and we'll call it an end. This is the comment I picked for today. It's a good one. Etho, what is your upload schedule? It would be very helpful to know, as knowing it would help me stop wasting time checking for new videos. Please respond. Ooh, well, do you guys know? Do you know what my upload schedule is? I don't have one. That's right, I don't have an upload schedule. I've thought about it, like, before, like, setting in stone exactly what I'm going to upload and when I'm going to upload it. But the problem with doing that is if I missed an episode or if I start falling behind, which happens quite a lot, actually, people would freak out. They would get mad at me, and I don't want that. I don't want people thinking they deserve an episode or that I have to make an episode. I make an episode if I can. I try to please people. Sometimes I fall behind, though, so it's not something I want to do. You might notice patterns, though, with my videos. Like with my Let's Plays, I try to upload them every 2, 3, or 4 days apart. It all depends on how much free time I have to make them, though. because they are the most time consuming thing I upload on my channel. I put the most effort into them, which is why people tend to prefer them out of all my videos. With the CTM map I'm playing right now, as long as I can keep up with that, I release that every second day at 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, I think. My Let's Play episodes I usually upload in the morning. Actually, most of my videos I upload in the morning, except for the CTM map. And yeah, if you're having trouble, or if you don't want to keep checking my channel, I also have my Twitter account linked to my YouTube channel, and it will post a message automatically whenever I upload a video. So that's another way you can keep in touch. And thank you for the question. Alright guys, I hope you enjoyed today's episode, and I will see you again next time.